tell you how excited I am about tonight. Not the least of the reasons is to see so many of you that thought this was worth your time. This is, all of you are Bible nerds like me. This is so exciting. We're so glad you've taken time to come out. I think it'll be worth your time tonight and next week as well. This is, as you know, we're decided to do this as sort of a launching point for our all-time bestseller book club. And for those of you that don't know about this, we are launching this week and next as a whole church community to read through the first two books of the Old Testament, the Bible, Genesis and Exodus, together. Do this on your own. There's a reading plan. You do it on your own. As couples, as a family, there's a children's plan and a family plan. Do it as a small group. We encourage as many of you as possible to pick up one of these, the story of God, reading through Genesis and Exodus together as we preach through Genesis and Exodus for the whole year. But one of the things we felt was pretty clear was folks are intimidated about reading the Old Testament, who haven't done it before or have tried and felt like they don't understand it and they need help. And so we talked with Dr. Walton. I don't know when that was. We had lunch many months ago, and he graciously agreed to come and do a lecture, and then we moved it to two lectures, and then we changed the date on him, I think, twice. And so he's still willing to come and do this. And I think, you know, I've been around a lot of really smart people. Some of them you feel like you're too dumb to listen to them. Dr. Walton's not one of those. His expertise is off the charts, but his accessibility is wonderful as well. So Dr. Walton has a PhD in Hebrew and Cognate Studies from the Hebrew Union College. I'm reading this from the website. Jewish Institute of Religion. He is MA of Wheaton College as well, in Old Testament and Wheaton Graduate School. Taught 25 years at Moody Bible Institute before coming to Wheaton. The courses he's taught are too long to list at Wheaton College, so I won't. But he's won recently, 2016, won the award, Christianity Today Award of Merit for Biblical Studies. His research includes specifically the ancient Near East and the world of the Old Testament, with a specific interest in the book of Genesis. Some of you may be aware that he's written a series of books called the Lost World series, the Lost World of Genesis 1, the Lost World of Adam and Eve. I have some of those here. Next week, we'll try to have a resource table available for those of you that would like to pick up some of his resources while you're here. You can certainly do that online without our help if you'd like to. He and his son, I think, have recently written a book, The Lost World of the Conquest, the Canaanite Conquest, which I'm super excited about when that comes out. And anyway, I could go on and on, but I won't because you didn't come here to listen to me. You came here to listen to Dr. John Walton. So welcome him with me, please.
Wow. Sunday night, and look at you. At First Bible Geek Church of Geneva or something like that. Just listening to him. It's really good to be here. I've spent my whole life pursuing a quest. A quest to be a faithful interpreter of God's Word. It's got its challenges. Probably you all know that. And especially with the Old Testament, it's got its challenges. Because we open its pages, and we can quickly become confused, puzzled. You know, we do a read through the Bible in a year, and you get to the third week in February, and Leviticus sets in. And you pray with all your heart, give me Matthew, please, give me Matthew. It's hard stuff. And so we need to get an idea of how are we supposed to get to God's message for us in this very difficult literature. And that's what I'd like to talk about in these 2 weeks. We can only brush the surface, but to try to give you some perspectives on how we can be confident in getting the authoritative message from God as we read the Old Testament. To do so, we have to know what we're doing. We have to know what it's doing. We have to know what we're looking for and what we're not looking for. And those will be some of the things that we talk about. We talk about biblical authority, and well, we should. And by that, we only recognize that since the Bible, as we understand it, is God's Word, that God has put His authority in it. It's ultimately God's authority. And our response is to submit to it. And that's kind of why we identify it as having authority. It comes from God, and we submit. We recognize that the Bible, therefore, has a right to speak to us because it comes from God. We also believe, then, that it is right in what it speaks to us because it comes from God. And so we rely on it. We trust it. And even though we adopt that stance, we still have the problem of interpreting it. So let's start by thinking about what God did when he passed an authoritative message on to humanity. God could have done that any number of different ways, but he decided to do it by vesting his authority in human communicators. We call them the authors of Scripture, but some of them are doing editing and these kinds of things, but I'll call them authors or communicators. The ones who had a hand in getting God's word to us. Those people don't have intrinsic authority, they only have authority from God. And what they wrote has authority because God prompted them to do so. God vouchsafed the process. Now, all of this is important. It might sound to you like, oh, this is stuff I've heard all the time. But follow the implication. The implication is that if we are going to get God's authoritative message, we have to go through those human authors to get it, because that's who he gave it to. We have to go through them. The message that they believe they are communicating is the message that God has given them that has authority that we submit to. God has vested his authority in human authors. And if we're going to get it, we can't go straight to God and skip the human author. We've got to go through the human author because that's how God did it. That means that even though the Bible was written for us, it was not written to us. It's not in our language. It's not in our culture. There are a lot of things that the author didn't try to explain to a 21st century Chicago suburbs audience. So, if we're going to get to what it is that the author has to communicate to us, that message of God, if we're going to get to that, we have to understand then that we have to read the Bible in its cultural context, and we have to read the Bible as the literature that it is. It's scripture, but it's cultural, and it's literary. We have to know how to penetrate the culture, and we have to know how to understand the literature. And those are the two parts that I want to talk about this week. Next week, we're going to spend time on particular genres within Scripture. What do we do with law? How do we read narrative? Okay, and we'll do as much of those as we can in the time that we have next week. But this week, I want to talk about those two elements, culture and literature. Now, the cultural one's the toughest nut to crack. But let's think through it a little so we know what we're doing and why we're doing it. I like to use the metaphor of a cultural river. And let's start by talking about our own cultural river a little bit. We're all floating in the cultural river that's the world around us, and particularly our country and our American culture. We're all kind of floating in that, and there are currents. And so here we are floating along, and we've got currents like individualism, democracy, freedom, rights. And some of those we feel okay about, you know, sometimes we wonder what they're doing and whether they're good, but we feel okay about those. And then we also have things like empiricism and consumerism. And some of those things, you think, oh boy, I'm not quite sure if that's a good thing. Maybe I ought to be kind of pushing against the current a little bit, trying to swim upstream on that one. We've got things like social media, capitalism. And we could go on for a good long time identifying the various currents in our cultural river. These are things we really didn't have to learn from anyone, so to speak. They're things that are inherent in the culture, and since we're born into this culture and live in this culture, they are us, whether we like them or not. And as a church of God's people, sometimes we say, this current is not a good one. And we have to speak against it, and we have to really swim upstream very, very hard to try to get out of that. And that's as it should be. But again, even when we're doing that, we're still in this cultural river. Okay, so have you got the idea of the cultural river here? Israel also had its cultural river. And it's a cultural river that was nothing at all like ours. None of the things that I've mentioned about ours are things that they knew. And I don't mean that they could have been like just foreign ideas to them. They didn't know them at all. Individualism, democracy, capitalism, rights, human rights, social media, right? We know they didn't know about these things. The authors of Scripture did not know our cultural river. They did not address our cultural river. And even more importantly, they did not anticipate our cultural river. Now, we don't like to hear that because it makes us feel like the Bible's not ours. It makes us feel like you've somehow just made it alien and that I can't get into it. Don't jump that far, but let's think about it. When I say then that the Bible is for us but not to us, I'm saying that the Bible indeed is written to another cultural river, with that cultural river in mind, but that it is still for us in our cultural river. It does not anticipate the details of our cultural river, but it comes as a message of God to us that will help us to figure out how to operate in the cultural river in which we find ourselves. The authors of Scripture did not anticipate our river, and God didn't build in little secret things for us to find. He didn't do that for the people of medieval Spain. He didn't do that for the Stone Age people in Borneo. He didn't do that for the Nigerians in Africa. He didn't do that. God doesn't work that way, to build in secret messages for every culture of every time and every place. Instead, he talks to people who have the problem of sin and need a solution, people who need to know their God and know what he's up to, enough so that they can hop on board and get involved with God's plans and purposes. But we have to figure out how that's going to work in our cultural river. We can't expect the Bible to address the details of our cultural river. It's not going to tell us about the ills of consumerism. We might find out that we should be concerned with things in heaven instead of things on earth, and that might help us to think about consumerism in new ways. But it doesn't address consumerism. Now, this suggests that if we're going to get the message, the authoritative message that the text has for us, that we have to understand their cultural river. Understand how God is revealing himself in that language, in that culture, and somehow try to make that very, very difficult jump. Now, you've had a lot of help on the language side of that equation, because people have translated the Bible for you, so you have it in your language. But again, you all know very well that just to have it in your language doesn't mean that all the cultural elements somehow, therefore, become clear. When Moses goes up onto Mount Sinai, and 40 days come and go, and he hasn't come back, and the people say, okay, well, I guess he's not coming back. I know, let's build a golden calf. And you should very rightfully say, what? Have they gone mad? Is a cultic cow party really going to do the job here? And so we don't know what's going on. And passage after passage after passage. Why is it that they can't wear material that's mixed linen and wool? Do I have to pay attention to that? They're working in their cultural river. And so we have to try to get into their cultural river. Tough job. Very difficult. What's in their cultural river? Let me give you some ideas. In their cultural river, there's a thing that I call the great symbiosis. I don't know the Hebrew word for symbiosis. They don't call it that, okay? But it describes what they do. In the great symbiosis that is all across the ancient world, it expresses the idea that gods for a long time existed on their own. And we're very content with that. But these gods, as they were imagined in the ancient world, had needs. They needed to eat, they needed housing, they needed clothing, they needed food and drink, and so they had these needs, and they were kind of working at providing them for themselves. And eventually they got tired of doing it for themselves. So they said, boy, need a solution. First they tried to give it to the younger gods, make the young people do it, you know? But need a solution. That didn't work. The young people rebelled. Surprise! Okay, and so what are we going to do now? Create people. Create slave labor. There's an idea. So in the ancient world, it was believed that people had been created to be slave labor to meet the needs of the gods. They would provide food, that was sacrifices. They would provide drink, libations. They would provide housing, glorious, splendid temples. And they would provide just a nice, pampered setting that any god would enjoy. Nice music while they ate a sumptuous meal, clothing of the highest quality. They would clothe the images that they made, okay? And so this idea that so gods needed people because people were meeting their needs. Well, of course, then they realized that if we depend on what people provide for us, we better provide for them. We better make sure we send rain. We better make sure we protect them from invasion. We've got to protect our people who provide for us. And this is that great symbiosis. The gods protect and provide for the people provide for the gods, and they develop this codependence of mutual need. That's the great symbiosis. It permeates the ancient world. It describes, in fact, the whole religious system of the ancient world. The people of Babylon or Egypt, their religious responsibility was care and feeding the gods. Take care of the gods, because then they'll take care of you. Now, that's the cultural river in which Israel was embedded, immersed. And that's how they most naturally thought. But God set it up differently. When God said that he was going to provide for Israel's needs and protect them from enemies, it wasn't because he was going to receive goods that would provide his needs. Instead of this codependency of mutual need, God made a covenant with his people. And in that covenant, he said, I will provide for you and protect you. I will prosper you. And this is what I want. I want you to be my partners. I want you to participate with me in my plans and purposes for the world. I want to live among you and be your God, and you will be my people. Don't fall into the trap of thinking that I need you. I own the cattle on 1,000 hills, he says in Psalm 50. If I were hungry, I wouldn't ask you. And so God was breaking that cycle. And we can see then that the Israelites were supposed to think differently from the world around them. But even so, that means they're supposed to swim against the current. But it doesn't get them out of their cultural river. And they struggle massively with getting past that standard way of thinking. Just like we would struggle trying to stop being individualists or consumers. Doesn't work real well. So, swimming against the current. But we won't understand Israel in its world if we don't understand the great symbiosis that is part of their cultural river and not at all part of ours. Although, perhaps you might say, I remember once, before I really got things straightened out, where I kind of thought God needed what I had to give him and that he would give me blessing when I gave it to him. Oh, but I got over it. I'm better now, okay? It's not, are we better? Anyway, so they've got their cultural river. Another thing in the cultural river, I'm not going to go through a lot of them, but another thing in the cultural river. See, in our world, especially post-Enlightenment, we got very strongly attached to this idea that what we experience in the world can be divided into the categories of natural and supernatural. Natural are those things that can be explained by natural cause and effect, natural laws, natural science, right? The normal, regular, everyday things that kind of just happen because the world is the way the world is. But then if there are things that we can't explain by natural laws or natural cause and effect, and we get the impression that this is something that God did, then we call it supernatural. And supernatural says that God intervened, perhaps to do a miracle, in order to do something supernatural that no science or sense of the natural world could ever give an explanation of. You recognize this system. It's how we think all the time. And so we've got these two categories of natural and supernatural. But think about it for a moment. Do we really think that the things that we call natural are things that God's not doing? Is God not involved? We use words like providence to try to kind of cover our tails on that. But somehow we still think that it's happening by itself, and I can demonstrate that because when something happens that can't be explained, we call it intervention. Think about that word intervention. Intervention suggests that God is outside, and that at some point, I need to do something here, and he steps in and does it. It puts God outside the system, only to step in when he wants to do a miracle. Now, that's our cultural river. That's how we set things up. That's how we think through issues. But that is not the ancient world, and it's not the biblical world of Israel. They have no category of natural. It doesn't exist. They don't call things miracles. You say, wait a minute. My Bible, it must say miracles. Maybe a translation does, but they don't call them that. They call them signs and wonders. Signs of God's power, of God's love for his people, wonders that are beyond what anyone would have expected for various reasons, signs and wonders. They don't talk about God intervening. They talk about God acting, but God is always acting in one way or another. In the ancient world, they don't have this divide. God is doing everything. And they don't divvy up the world that way. The Bible does not anticipate our world where we divvy it up and try to explain to us in our post-Enlightenment system how we should cut the deck. God's doing everything. Nothing God's not involved in. They thought differently than we do. This affects some of the passages that we read. We read the Tower of Babel. And from our cultural standpoint, in our cultural river, we think that this is some enormous project of humanism to build up to where God is, and depending on the interpreter, to overthrow God or to sit alongside of God or any number of different things, that this is the humanistic reach of humanity into the heavens, a challenge to God. And we assume that they did so in their great overweening pride in humanity. Makes great Greek literature, I suppose, and for our own modern scenario, but that's not the situation in the ancient world. See, we know what this tower was. It was what's called a ziggurat. And their standard projects for an ancient city. And they were typically built next to the temple. And they were sacred space, only for the gods, not for people at all. You wouldn't catch anybody in the ancient world trying to go even three steps up the ziggurat. Sacred space, for the gods only. And they built it not so they could go up. They built it so that God would come down. Now, you wouldn't know that just reading your English version in front of you. You wouldn't know what this tower was or what it did. The whole idea was that God would come down and be worshipped in the temple. You say, well, that sounds pretty good, actually, that they would want to do that. Well, but God didn't like it. Notice the verse 5 says, and so God did come down. It's exactly what they built it for. And he looked around and he said, oh no, not going to happen. Why? Well, the text tells us they were trying to make a name for themselves. And we have usually interpreted that in our uninformed reading, that refers to their pride. But in the ancient world, making a name was a good thing. It was something that everyone tried to do, because in the ancient world, to make a name for yourself means that you have done something so that you will be remembered when you die. And that's a perfectly legitimate pursuit. In fact, the way that most people did that was by having children. Because there's no more likely place for you to be remembered than among your descendants. Making a name could be done out of pride, but there's nothing inherent in the phrase to suggest that. So what was the problem? I mean, here they're embarking on a great adventure. After all, if you're going to build something so that God's presence can come down, that's a memorable thing. That's very cool. So what was God upset about? Well, you have to notice the grammar here. They said, let us make a name for ourselves. Now, if they are trying to reestablish sacred space, Who should they be making a name for? For God. Sacred space is God's place. Sacred space is the temple. And the temple is there to exalt God's name. Remember Deuteronomy, God's going to show them a place, and he will put his name there. And his name will be exalted there. Sacred space is to exalt God's name. Now, you wouldn't have known it was sacred space if you didn't know what a ziggurat was. We needed the ancient world for that. And you wouldn't know that there was a issue, what the issue was with making a name, if we didn't get into the cultural a little bit. But now we find out, we ask the question, well, why did they think that bringing sacred space back, remember, sacred space had been lost at Eden, the fall, lost access to God's presence gone. Genesis 3 is not paradise lost, it's presence lost. They want it back. Now, theoretically, they should want it back because of who God is and what his presence means. But let's put the pieces together. Let's connect the dots. We just learned about the great symbiosis. And in the great symbiosis, the reason why you want to have a God dwell among you is so that you can pamper that God, so that that God will bring blessing and prosperity on you and thereby make a name for you. Okay, now the pieces are fitting together here. We understand sacred space. We understand ziggurats. We understand great symbiosis and what's going on with a name and a temple. And the passage suddenly becomes something very different from what we ever imagined. And if that weren't enough, we then find out that since God rejects that initiative, he's not going to reestablish his presence that way, that he has a counter initiative. Tower of Babel's in Genesis chapter 11. Genesis chapter 12. God said to Abraham, I want you to leave your land and your family, and I'm going to make a covenant with you. The covenant is God's counter initiative. Now, what does the covenant have to do with what was going on at the Tower of Babel? Well, in the covenant, God is going to make them a large family. And what's that family going to do? They're going to live in the land that God gives them. Is he just giving them land because, well, everybody needs a place to stay? No. Because he's giving them tenancy in the land that is his land. And it's his land because he is going to dwell there. Tabernacle, temple. And Israel is designated a kingdom of priests, a large family, to serve the presence of God in the land that he has chosen to dwell in. And so it is through the covenant that God is going to reestablish his presence on earth. And through you, all the peoples of the earth will be blessed. Now, usually when I ask a class, so what's this blessing that it's talking about? Ooh, because they all grew up in Sunday school, and they know that any time you ask a question about the Bible, the answer is, Jesus! Well, certainly, all the world is blessed through Jesus, but it didn't wait till then. All the world is blessed because God dwells here. And he did that in Israel. All the world is blessed because God revealed himself. Many ways in which the world is blessed because of God's covenant with Israel. Context changes everything. How we think about the Bible, how we penetrate the Old Testament. And you might say, okay, I'm feeling scared now because I have no idea how to do that. See, what I'm basically suggesting to you, here's the scary part, is that intuitive reading is unreliable. Intuitive reading is unreliable. Why? Because when we read intuitively, we're reading through the filter of our cultural river. You never read as a cultural blank. You can't. And when we are reading intuitively, we are imposing our cultural river on the text. Occasionally someone has said to me, well, you're imposing the ancient Near East on the text. You can't impose the ancient Near East on the text. It's embedded in the ancient Near East. It's just like I couldn't impose Hebrew on the text. It is in Hebrew. So we have to recognize that that is the world in which it is operating. Now, people get concerned about any number of things here. Let's try to talk about a few of them. First of all, people say, but wait, our access to the ancient world is just over the last century or so. What about all the early Christian writers? What about the reformers? What about all the people that came before? So you're saying that since they did not have access to the ancient world, and they didn't, they would have liked to, I think, but that because they didn't have access to the ancient world, that they're all wrong? No. They weren't trying to get access to the ancient world. And yes, like most of us do, they often read their own culture into it. They don't have to do much reading in the early Christian writers or the reformers to see that that's the case. They were aware of it, but they had no option. But the other thing is, they recognized how that was a hindrance. And they were really just trying to put together, more often than not, trying to put together, well, what should our theology today be? And here we're talking more about how are we interpreting individual passages. They're a little bit different questions. See, in all of your Bible reading, however long you've been at it, you probably have gotten a pretty good idea of what is actually, yes, sound theology. And there's no problem with that. We understand our human plight. We understand our sin and our need of a Savior. We understand that God has made provision for us. We understand that God has a plan and purpose and we're supposed to participate with Him. We understand that there's a kingdom of God and we are participants in that. We understand that we're in the image of God and therefore He has asked us, created us indeed, to work alongside of Him. Those are not hard things to understand. We get them all pretty well figured out, so we're not in horrible shape. The cultural background certainly can help us to learn more about that ancient world, because the literature we have gives us windows into that world. More importantly, the cultural background can help us to identify those places where we are reading in our culture and we didn't know it. In other words, what it prevents us from is almost more important than what it gets us to. If we can at least understand our inclination to read our own cultural river in and to understand that we probably shouldn't be doing that, that can clear away some of the blinders that we have. Now, but of course we don't want to just talk about what those negative effects that we want to avoid. We want to talk about how can we make progress on this. Well, fortunately, in the last couple of decades, people have finally started working on trying to make all that we know about the ancient world available to non-scholars, to very smart people, very committed people, spiritually minded people, but without access to those ancient texts or to the obscure journals in which that stuff is published. And so there are now more tools available for you to access that information. The most recent one that came out, I'm very happy to say, is the Cultural Background Study Bible. There's a whole study Bible, and the notes are not about theology or interpretation of a passage. All the notes are backgrounds notes. History, archaeology, manners and customs, ancient literature, all of those kinds of things to help you understand the ancient world of the text. So I was the Old Testament general editor for this. Craig Keener is the New Testament general editor. And we have a whole team of people that we worked with to try to put that information into your hands, the Cultural Background Study Bible. Now, in this, you'll find right up at the beginning, let me see. It's right somewhere right up here. Right here. Major background issues in the ancient Near East starts with a description of the cultural river, just like I described it here. And then it goes through 12 of the key areas where the ancient world differed from us. 12 key areas to describe the ancient cultural river, including great symbiosis and those kinds of things. So there are tools that are now being prepared to make this material accessible to you. There are books that talk about it. For instance, here's a book by Randy Richards and Brandon O'Brien called Misreading Scripture with Western Eyes. Yeah. Cultural river stuff. So this is more of a how-to kind of thing. What? Not how to misread it, but how to avoid misreading it. So, text like that. This one just came out recently, Glenn Paul. Saving the Bible from Ourselves. Yeah. Saving the Bible from Ourselves. He's got lots of great stuff in here. This is very readable. And it's got a powerful message to it. So there are tools that are available to give you this information. And remember, the reason we're doing this is because we want to get as clear a view of the authority of God's word as we can. And that means we have to go through that portal that's the ancient author who sits there speaking in his language to his audience in his cultural river. And we need to make the jump. So we could talk a lot more about that. I do whole courses on this stuff, but that gives you an idea of the cultural aspect. Now I want to go to the literary aspect. Not only do we have to get in touch with the culture of the ancient world, we have to get in touch with how literature works in the ancient world so that we can understand the Bible on a literary level. Again, there's nothing wrong with understanding the Bible as literature because we're not saying that it's only literature. I went to a secular college and took a course that was the Bible as literature. And the course was very specifically designed to say, yeah, just literature, not scripture. So some people get the wrong idea that somehow when we talk about evaluating it as literature, that's somehow taking away from it. But that's not the case. Okay, remember, the culture of the ancient world produced literature in its own forms, its own genres. And so we want to try to understand how the author did what he did. How did he package that material? Part of that's going to be involved with genres. That's next week. Okay, but I want to get the bigger picture tonight, the theoretical picture of how that all works. When we understand that the text's authority rests in the author, that gives us the idea that we need to be tracking with the author. Even in something as basic as Bible stories, however, that's not usually what we do. We read the stories as sort of independent stories. Glenn Paul calls it the snacking Bible. you know, picking this and that, whether it's your verse for the day or your Bible reading for the morning or the little Bible story that you're telling, the snacking Bible. And he wants to urge us to look at the feasting Bible. And he talks some about that. I'm not going to repeat what he says. But part of that is trying to understand the larger portions of Scripture and how they work. So, for instance, just to whet your appetite a little for next week, when we talk about narratives, the Bible stories, in these narratives, we often focus on the characters, the people, and what they are doing. But people are not authoritative. The text is authoritative. The narrator is authoritative. And therefore, it's much more important what the narrator is doing with these characters than what the characters are doing. What they're doing doesn't matter so much. What the narrator is doing with them is important, because that's where the authority is. Lots of times we want to try to fill in the gaps. Say, oh, you know, the narrator skipped this part. Let's try to figure out. So exactly how did Sarah think about this when Abraham is taking Isaac to be sacrificed? Let's imagine, oops. Imagine, really? Imagine will never get you to authority. We don't want to go imagining. We can't psychoanalyze these characters. We can't fill in the gaps of their personalities or their motivations. We can't give them a Myers-Briggs test. We've got what the narrator gave us. And that's enough, because that has authority. Stick with it. So, what the narrator does with the character is more important than what the character does. And most important of all is what God is doing through the character. God works through some pretty despicable people, including all of us sometimes. And just because God works through someone doesn't put them on a pedestal. They're fallen humans just like any of us are. But God works through them just as he works through us. So it's not as important what the character is doing as what the narrator is doing with the character and what God is doing through the character. That means we have to focus on the literature, because that's how that unfolds. We'll talk more about that next week. Now, another thing we have to understand then is that the Bible is not working in little blips, in our little thought for the day or verse for the day. The Bible doesn't communicate that way. It communicates in contexts. Even the Bible stories are not self-standing, autonomous units to be read just by themselves. Those stories were each selected carefully by the author who put the book together. And they work in tandem, in juxtaposition, in series. They work together to accomplish the purpose that the author had. We can't just pull out an individual story as if it's all there by itself. They work together. Now, we call this idea of the book as a whole, we refer to it as the rhetorical strategy of the book. We assume that the author had a purpose, and he usually doesn't tell us what it was. You know, in the Gospel of John, it's wonderful. These things were written that you might believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son. Great. That I love that. I wish everybody had done that. It would make our job a little bit easier, you know. Get to the end of Judges and have them tell us why. What are you doing here, pal? Okay, so, yeah, we don't usually have that. That means we have to put on our literary thinking caps and try to understand from the evidence we have. Notice I didn't use the word imagine. But try to use the clues that the author has left us to understand his purpose. And we typically do that by starting with some of the main themes that we identify in the book, and then trying to identify how all of the different parts of the book contribute. How do those themes, how does each chapter, each segment, how does that contribute to a purpose? And so we try to work out, based on the evidence before us, what the author's purpose is and how he's trying to achieve that purpose. Because once we can put that together, then we have to interpret each account based on, most importantly, the contribution it makes to the author's purpose. Because then we're tracking with the author. And that's where authority is. Authority is when we're tracking with the author. That's how God did it. We have all kinds of ways that we sometimes use to pull a message out of a narrative. I hope here I'm not going to step on the toes of any of you or any of your pastors or any of the people you listen to on the radio, but here goes. So, so David has seen Goliath making his challenges in the valley. And he makes the arrangements with Saul. Everyone's just incredulous that he's going to do this. Goes down with his sling, which is very skillful at, by the way, in which Goliath knows what a sling can do. But at any rate, that's a side piece. Okay, he goes down, and before approaching Goliath, he chooses 5 smooth stones from the riverbed. I hope this is not a sermon you've ever heard. What are the 5 stones in your bag by which you go to slay the giants in your life? From posing that question, there's no place to go but down. Because no matter what you say those 5 stones are, you're making it up. It can't have authority. Whoever the giants are in your life, that may give you some sense of application, but it doesn't get you to the authority of the text. And too often, we are willing to settle for sound bites and inspiring insights, instead of pursuing single-mindedly the authority of the biblical text. And I get it. I know that that's often because we don't know what else to do with it. We don't know how to get to what we need to get to. Now, some other things to help. What else did I bring here? Richard Schultz, my colleague at Wheaton, out of context, how to avoid misinterpreting the Bible. We can use that. Again, that's something like saving the Bible from ourselves. Okay, there are things we have to change about how we read the Bible. Strategies that will help us get to more confident assessment of the authority of the text. If you're interested in what is the purpose of this biblical book or that one, I did a book with Mark Strauss called The Essential Bible Companion. Essential Bible Companion has like one spread for each book of the Bible. Here's numbers. It gives you the purpose of the book and tells you how it's worked out. Gives you key verses, key teachings about God, key terms, all on one little spread. The Essential Bible Companion. There are helps. A more extensive level, this is one of the books that I use for a textbook in my classes at Wheaton, Old Testament Today. This is not just interested in the content of the Old Testament, but in how we read the Old Testament. And again, this will carry over into the genres that we talk about next week as well. So there are tools out there if we want to try to get a hold of them and think through it. We often believe that we can somehow extract the authority of God's word by pulling out little proof texts. Whatever the issue is, we think that somehow there must be a proof text somewhere that gives us a biblical view. But all of that assumes that the Bible works in its little sound bites, which it doesn't. And it assumes that we can just read it for our cultural river, which we can't. And as a result, we try to solve all our problems, whether they're social issues, big controversial things, political issues, how to find God's will for my life, or we think we can find all of those because we've come to believe that somehow that's what the Bible is. But the Bible is God's revelation of himself. Not all of himself the books could not contain. It's not all. And really, as human beings, frail and limited as we are, we can only kind of make little forays into all of that. But he has given us enough so that we can understand what his plans and purposes are for this world. He's given us enough so we can participate in that and be people of the kingdom. He's given us enough to say we can trust him, and this is a worthwhile enterprise, and I want to be in. He's given us enough to understand the kind of identity that he wants us to have as his people. That doesn't give you a solution to every problem, but at least it tells you how to start thinking that we are his people. We have been brought into the circle of his identity. He has called us his own. And we are supposed to participate with him in all of that. We come to know God the same way as we come to know people. And I'll end with this illustration, then we can open it up for questions. We come to know God. Well, let's start with the other side. We get to know people. How do we get to know other people? Well, I just met a few of you tonight. And, you know, you shake hands, you trade names. And maybe you'll ask, so what do you do? How long have you been coming here? What are we doing when we trade that kind of information? We're basically sharing story. The most basic element of your story is your name and what you kind of busy yourself with. And here, I'd like you to meet my wife or my husband, you know. Story sharing. And when you get to know people better, you know, when you mill around out in the vestibule and you get to know people a little better, what are you doing? You're hearing more of their story. And when you really have someone you consider a friend, if someone says, do you know so-and-so, and they're a friend of yours, you're going to say yes, and probably the next words out of your mouth will be part of their story that shows that you know them. And when you really feel like you're getting into an intimate relationship with someone, you sense this desire to hear all of the story over and over again. And the more you share your story and the more they share their story is how you feel like you know them. Now, my wife and I just had our 40th anniversary this last summer. Woohoo! Yes, yes. And, you know, we've had a life of sharing story. Some couples get tired of it after a while. They don't want to hear the stories anymore. They feel like the story's changing or whatever, you know. But that's not us. We just love the story sharing, even if we're not really very interested in the content of the story. You know, some of the things that my wife does day by day, the content of that isn't really that exciting to me. But the fact that she is sharing her story with me, that's important. And so I listen. because she's sharing story, and I'm getting to know her that way. Now, does that mean after 40 years that I can never be surprised? No, it does not. Okay? My knowledge is still limited. But that's the way in which I would talk about that I know my wife, because I know that I can trust her and depend on her. I know that I love her. And I know that there's a lot of who she is that I find very attractive. But I don't know everything that she's going to do at any given moment. Now, if there are that kind of limitations that we have among ourselves, think of the limitations we have with God. But yet, my wife and I are engaged in a great enterprise of life together, and of the things that we do in ministry. And we know plenty enough to partner with each other and to understand what's driving us in what we do and to share in those plans and purposes. And that's what it is with God. The Bible is God's story that he has given us as part of his communication of himself to us. He communicates his plans and purposes, and through those, we can come to know him more and more. And he wants to hear our story as well. Not because he doesn't know it already. The power is in the telling, the listening. And so he wants to hear our stories. We call it prayer. And he gives us his story. We call it the Bible. And that's how we share story and share enterprise. We partner together. So, an illustration of that, when I give out my syllabus in class, okay? My students read the syllabus, and they might infer some things about me. They might say, oh, he thinks he's got a little flair for design. But, you know, okay, I can see that. You know. Oh, he's organized, like, okay. And they can kind of discern a little bit. But what am I giving them in the syllabus? I'm giving them my plans and purposes for the semester. The objectives are there. They know what I'm up to. They know what their part in it is. They know how that's going to work out. And I've given them enough so they can participate along with me in this educational enterprise. And how much they actually get to know me, well, some more than others. But they've got enough to participate in this undertaking. It's kind of a lot like the Bible. God has revealed to us his story, so that we can understand his plans and purposes and find our role in that story and participate with him as kingdom people, identifying with him because he has identified with us. Thank you.
So we're going to have some time for questions. There's one mic. I think Laura has a mic and Randall has a mic, or somebody else does. So if you have a question, raise your hand. We'd like to get these. We're recording this session, so we'd like also to record your questions. So please wait for the microphone to come around. I'm going to preempt it by asking what I'm sure will be asked, or if it isn't, it ought to be asked. You said intuitive reading is unreliable. I'm wondering if anybody out there thought, wait a second, so what about devotional reading? What about reading the Bible just for devotional inspiration? Is that a bad idea?
Well, it may give you some inspiration for application, but it won't get you to the authority of the text if your own filter is getting in the way. Again, I say it's not reliable. That's not the same thing as saying it's wrong or that it's always false. It's not reliable because you may get truth, you may not, depending on the cultural river issues, okay? So I carefully chose that word, unreliable.
We have one in the back, yeah.
You used as an example of something that's very culturally specific, the linen fibers and don't mix, and that you know, whether that applies to us, we have to look at cultural context. What's the method by which we determine what is and is not specifically, very culturally specific, and what may or may not apply to us because of that?
I love it. Thank you. Thank you for that question. Okay, we've only got a couple options. You can say, none of the Bible is culturally relative. We can all just bring it all straight across. We all know that doesn't work. I notice that some of you are wearing mixed fabrics in your clothing. We know that doesn't work. Okay? Then there's the middle ground that says, as was just spoken of, where, okay, some of it is and some of it's not, and we have to try to figure out a way so we can figure out what is culturally relative and what is not. And exactly the problem that he mentioned. How do we do that? What criteria do we use for setting some of it aside and saying the rest is not culturally relative? The Bible doesn't give us a method. We can't just use the New Testament affirms it, or it's not denied in the New Testament. We can't use that because the New Testament is not trying to give you the criteria by which you make cultural decisions in the Old Testament. And that way, no one's going to give you the cultural criteria for the New Testament. That doesn't work. So we sit here saying, okay, but if the criteria that we use are all of our own design, then aren't we just picking those things that we believed anyway and dismissing those things that we didn't? And isn't it then our authority and not the Bible's? You know the problem. These are the struggles we have with all kinds of issues where people are trying to use biblical proof texts and somebody will say, oh, you can't use that one. That's culturally relative. We're going to use this one as if that one's not culturally relative. That's the second. The third position is to say it's all culturally relative. That's the one I'm going to pick. Now you say, oh, okay, but just because it's culturally relative doesn't mean it's no longer any good to us. It doesn't mean that it's no longer relevant to us. It only means we have to go through the steps recognizing that it's culturally relative and then having the means by which we can use that text anyway for what it is designed to do. And again, I don't want to hold it up too often, but this is what he talks about, using the text for what it's designed to do. And that's why I talked about that tonight. What is the text doing? And once we recognize that big picture of what it's doing, and by the way, I don't view that as reductionistic. I mean, it's this is riddled all through the text, but it's always talking into a culture to do that. That doesn't mean that we can say, oh, well, you know, it says don't murder, but it's culturally relative, and so I can do whatever I want. No, not at all. Our task is to identify with the Holy God who died for us, gave us a righteous status before God, calls us as his people, and says, live like it. Well, but will that tell me what decision to make here? No, it won't. Well, how am I supposed to figure it out? And one of the things that Glenn Powell tells us is, certainly not by yourself. There's community for a reason. Because otherwise we end up going rogue and just making the Bible be what we want it to be.
Here's one.
This might be really basic, but did each of the author know the purpose they were writing the book for when they started writing it? Because I know my story, I quite often miss the purpose and only see it in retrospect.
Good question. And I believe they did. Now, why do I believe that? Okay. Well, they've been selective. And you typically aren't randomly selective. I mean, they've picked the stories of David that they picked. They picked the stories of Saul that they picked. They picked they picked the stories they picked. And you can actually see how those purposes are worked out. Now, it may be that eventually on some book or another, we can conclude, boy, I don't see the purpose in this one. But that's never our starting point. Our starting point is assuming there is a purpose and doing our best to find it. Now, I'll have to admit, a book like Jeremiah, it's really hard to identify how Jeremiah is structured. But as a prophet of God in the time period in which he lived, it's not hard to figure out what he's doing overall, even if the structure of the book eludes us. Okay, so our default is going to be, yes, there is structure.
In the back, and then up here. Go ahead, Scott. Well, while you're figuring, oh, you got it.
We're there?
There we go. Okay, so back to your comments regarding cultural relativism. So it's very easy when we talk about New Testament, Old Testament, and we say, we see some things in Levitical law, and we go, nope, that's bound to, say, the Israelites. But we have this moral section of the law. We often do these sorts of things. It gets muddier when we get to the New Testament, because there are very clearly certain commands that occur in New Testament that we have now written off and said, no, that's cultural as well. For instance, praying with heads covered or something of that nature. So what do you do? How is it that you begin to unpack what you would say is culturally relative and no longer binding on a church today versus that which is?
Well, first of all, I just pay attention to the Old Testament. Oh, wait, no. Okay. Edit the video on that. Okay. No, of course, we have to deal with those issues as well. And again, I would make the same statement in the New Testament. It's all culturally relative. Again, that doesn't mean it therefore immediately becomes irrelevant. It's still God's word communicated to people in that culture in that time that we have to make some sense of. Okay, so how do we go about deciding? Okay, we work as the community of the church to discern as best we can how God's purposes and plans can be served. Again, we can't prove text. And we do it in community because that's how God kind of set us up to work. We run into these problems and we say, we've got to solve this by next week or next year. Remember, the early church, the early Christian writers, what was it, 300 years before they sorted out Christology and figured out how to express the idea of Jesus as the Son of God and how the Trinity works? Hundreds of years to sort all that out. So we shouldn't think that the big problems that we tackle can just be solved overnight. We have to work at it as the community of God's people. But again, it's not going to give us a silver bullet. It's not going to give us that one proof text that just nails it all.
Could you speak to the role of the Holy Spirit in interpreting the ancient rivers, the truth embedded within that context, and how we apply that to today's river?
Excellent. I was going to put that in my talk, but I said, no, somebody will ask. I'll just save it for the Q&A. So the role of the Spirit. The role of the Spirit, of course, is kind of interwoven throughout the whole process by which Scripture gets to us and we read it. After all, the Spirit moved authors to communicate. So the Spirit was involved on the author level. The Spirit inspired the text. It's the graphe, the writings that are God-breathed. And so the Spirit was involved to make sure that what got finally written in by the authors into text was also God's word. And so just as the Spirit works with the authors and works with the text, the Spirit works in us. But the Spirit doesn't redo in us what it already did in the author and the text. And the Spirit does not have specifically the task of helping us to understand it in the sense of interpreting. You know, I don't think I've ever had the Spirit parse a Hebrew verb for me or tell me some detail of Assyrian history. Maybe he's helped me figure that stuff out, but, you know, tough to, okay? The Spirit doesn't work that way. The Spirit for the reader is engaged in helping us to respond to the truth that's already there. Not trying to tell us what that message is, not trying to give us a new expanded message, but to help us respond to the message that is there, that's there for everybody. But we all will respond in accordance with our own situations and lives and personalities and challenges and all of that. The Spirit then helps us respond so that we are actively engaged in living into the identity that God has given us. So the Spirit has a very important role, because if that doesn't happen, then we've just got a piece of literature that we've studied academically, and it's at arm's length, and it's not affecting our lives. That wouldn't be good. It's the Spirit that moves the next step and says, okay, what are you going to do about that? So it's more the application level. There's a book that just came out, I didn't bring it along, by Craig Keener called Spirit Hermeneutics. And he tries to track this path between don't give up on the technical academic aspects of interpretation, but likewise, don't leave it there, recognize what the Spirit does. Now, he comes at it from a Pentecostal charismatic direction, which may work for some of you, may not work for some of you, but still, what he has to say about the role of the Spirit is pretty much on target in terms of how we're reading text.
So you mentioned proof texting, and I'm sure a lot of us grew up with memorizing scripture, memorizing specific versions of scripture and that sort of thing. And so it's really easy. I mean, I feel like I grew up proof texting. Recognizing our own bias, is it maybe a general idea that the larger the themes, the more we can have confidence in, and the more specific we get, the more we need to be cautious of our own bias?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, again, the idea is that if we just pull out a snippet of text, we're running great risks. We're running risks of misunderstanding it. We're running risks of extracting it from its meaningful context that would help us understand it. And we also run the risk of being selective. Powell had some great examples in here. Can I quick turn to them? I don't know if I can or not. But where he identified, should have marked that one. But there are certain passages that we always go to. I know I have plans for you, plans for a hope and a future, and things of that sort. And so we do those, but here it is. Then we can get to these. You will be unsuccessful in everything that you do. Day after day, you will be oppressed and robbed, and no one will rescue you. That's in the Bible. We are an aroma that brings death. Put that one on your refrigerator. I have labored in vain. I have spent my strength for nothing at all. It somehow wasn't in our Bible memory packet. One more. The Lord will give you an anxious mind, eyes weary with longing, and a despairing heart. We're selective when we do these little proof texts. And it's the same thing, not only when we're trying to receive encouragement, those aren't very encouraging, but when we're trying to solve problems. We pick out a text that we think solves our problem. And again, it's an unreliable process because it doesn't take account of things that are important for understanding what the author was communicating. The author has the authority. We've got to track with him. Here's another way to say it. We are accountable both to the words of the text and to the intention of the author. We are accountable. We have to keep that accountability. We can't go rogue, else it's not God's authoritative word anymore.
There are a few places. I'm over here, sorry. There are just a few places in the New Testament where we kind of get a glimpse of how Jesus treated the Old Testament. One that comes to mind for me is when he's talking about divorce, and he says, Moses said, you know, that you could go through this process for divorce, but that was never God's plan from the beginning. And I tell you, and then he goes on. Are there those few instances where we see how he refers to Scripture or sums up Scripture that you have found helpful or that kind of underscore what you're teaching, or how have you approached any of kind of Jesus's treatment?
What we see is when Jesus deals with scripture like that, he often drags them to the bigger purpose and the bigger picture. And he did that with divorce. He did it with the commandments. You know, you've heard it said, you shall not murder. Now, I'll tell you, there's a whole lot more going on than that. And you better be careful you're not even hating your neighbor. So Jesus always pulls them to the bigger picture. What does it mean to be part of the kingdom of God? What is this kingdom of God? Always big picture stuff. He does use the text, but to point to bigger pictures. If you want to understand that better, there's a book that just came out by Richard Hayes called Echoes of Scripture in the Gospels. Now, I have to warn you, it's tough sledding. This is a 500-page book. Again? Oh, Richard Hayes, okay, Echoes of Scripture in the Gospels. It's a 500-page book, and it's quite plodding, but some of you are not shy about that kind of reading at all. And so he talks about how the gospel writers are using the Old Testament to build this big picture of the kingdom and of who Jesus is. So a very interesting study.
Other questions? Good. Let's play Stump the Professor. Craig, you're next.
I always call it Stump the Chump.
Well, just, yeah. You can say that.
I wonder, given your interpretation then of approaching the narrative of the Old Testament, what was the purpose of telling us that there were five smooth stones?
Mm-hmm. Oh, golly, look at the time. No. We could give all kinds of cultural explanations, but we'd just be guessing. It would make sense that he picks ones of different weight, different size, just in case he gets in different situations. He doesn't know what he's going to face, what kind of distance he has to do. Of course, if he misses on one, he's got to use another one. So there are all kinds of very easy contextual explanations. But the fact is, the text is not making a spiritual lesson out of it.
I think I'm next. Hi. I'm over here.
Okay.
You know, with all the so many Bibles written today, and like I think of the Message Bible, how do we know when it keeps being reinterpreted over and over and over by not the authors actually, but man? So I guess it gets a little tricky with trusting the authority.
Remember that no translation has authority in and of itself. To translate requires you to interpret. And interpretation is not authoritative. Now, we do believe that a worthy translation can give us access to the authoritative text. But that always has the qualifier in there, insofar as it actually represents what the text says. And the translators do their work as well as they can. I've worked on a number of translations, and I know it's a difficult job, and it's, you know, as a translator, you come out saying, well, I tried to do the best that I could in the time that I had and the strictures I was given, but, you know, certainly somebody can do it better, and I hope someday will. I mean, it's that kind of situation. So interpretation is required in order to translate. After all, you can't say, what does this mean in English language until you figure out what it means in Hebrew. And so that's the difficulty with translation. But again, we don't have to despair because of that, because translations at least can give us access to that authoritative word and can do it pretty well. Okay, now, another problem that translators face is that there are numerous Hebrew words, important ones, that don't have a clear English equivalent. Now you're in trouble, because you want to translate that word, but there's really no English word that does the same thing as that Hebrew word. People don't like it if you leave spaces in the text, okay? And they don't like it if you translate that word with a paragraph, okay? So we have certain limitations, but that's the truth of it. So, for instance, in this Cultural Background Study Bible, I've got something right at the beginning. I've got a list of about 50 Hebrew words that are difficult to translate by one word. And so I've got the word there, and then I've got a paragraph to say, and this is what this word is really getting at. So that, again, you can bridge that gap better than if you just have a translation that's tried to give you an English word to cover it. Okay, so again, we try to make tools available, but we have to do a lot of work along the way. You know, example, when my wife and I were celebrating our 40th, I had a gig over in Scotland for a couple days, and so I just said, come on, come with me, and we'll do my gig, but then we'll spend a few extra days and kind of celebrate our anniversary. And she says, well, I don't know if I have enough time to prepare for that. I said, prepare? Yeah, well, we have to get all the travel books and go online and look at all the sites and the things there are to see and kind of see how much, when the hours are and how much they cost. And and I'm going, you know, I thought we were just going to go over and kind of walk around, you know. But no, that was not her idea about it at all. And I'm glad she prevailed in all of that, because we'd have just been walking around and not know what in the world we were doing or what we should have seen. So just a trip to Scotland took a lot of time, effort, preparation, so that we made the most of the journey. You get the picture. Why should reading Bible be any less so? Time, effort, preparation to make the journey worthwhile.
Okay, we're right at the time we said we'd end, but we have one more question, and then we'll sort of have an official end, and if you would like to stick around, I'm sure we can coerce Dr. Walton into staying longer and answering more questions.
My question was sort of similar to the last one, but it was, and it's kind of come out in a theme, I think, you made a statement about interpreting within community, and I guess, how do you choose the community? Because there's a way that seems right to a man, but that way leads to destruction. I mean, there is a lot of stuff out there that you're like, that is really going off, you know, into left or right field. So, you know, you've referenced a number of books, which, you know, we don't have a relationship. Okay, my son goes to Wheaton, so it's like, okay, we're there. But there's a lot of people out there providing information that, at least listening to you this evening, would also be disinformation. So how do we know?
And there's a place where we can say, we believe that the Spirit is at work in the community. Not to give us the authority of the text, but help us discern. It's the Spirit that leads us to wisdom, to kind of understand where's going the right direction and what's not. You know, when I talk about the community, it wasn't so much a concern of which one, although it's a valid question, but rather the contrast, all on my own in my prayer closet or in community. And community is a choice. Now, again, you're right. You've got the choice. Which community are we talking about? And here I'm talking about simply that a church is going to provide education opportunities for people to get together, whether it happens in small groups or it happens in adult ed classes or all the different ways that it happens, kind of within the church community. I mean, the whole idea of having an elder board and deacon board, whatever you call it here, governing boards, is so that you've got a community of people that can try to make the hard calls and give leadership. And so, yes, there are bad communities out there, no question about it. And that's one of the ways that we look to the Spirit to give us wisdom. You know, I believe the Spirit was involved in the process that led to the creeds and the councils in early Christianity. Again, it's not the same kind of work that was done with the authors or with the text of Scripture, but the Spirit involved nonetheless in His people, in the people of God. Well, I'll hang around up here. If you want to come look at some of these books, you can. And,
Yeah, let me just wrap up with a couple of announcements, and then we'll sort of have an official break. And if you'd like to stay and talk more informally, we can do that. First of all, just want to say again, thank you for coming out tonight. I hope this is valuable to you. It's been a great encouragement to me. We're going to do it again next week. We will have some of Dr. Walton's books available for sale next week, and we'll try to get some of these resources he's mentioned here as well for you to purchase next week if you don't like Amazon or want to support them for some reason. And let me say, Dr. Walton said several times, reading in community, reading in narrative chunks, not little small sound bites or little digestive bits, you know, like for devotional readings, little fridge magnet reading. That's the whole point of the book club. If you think I'm plugging the book club, I am. right? Sign up. Read the Bible in community. Don't read it in tiny little bits in isolation. That's why we're doing this, to read God's word for God's people together. And so do that. You can do that tonight as you leave. You can grab a book on your own. You can think about signing up. You can sign up right now or online this week. Please don't miss this opportunity to do just that. We are videotaping these sessions. So if you'd like to review some of the stuff, there's a lot of deep waters here. If you want to think about this more, you can access those online on our church website. And come back next week and bring a friend. Let's say thank you to Dr. Walton. And let me just wrap us up with a prayer. I so appreciated your comment about we relate to God the same way we get to know anybody else, through the sharing of story. That really spoke to my heart. Thank you for that. Let's bow together. Father God, we confess that we are on our own with our finite minds, in our particular cultural streams, not sufficient. But thank you that you are, and that you've given us what we need. Each other, your spirit, your authoritative word. Help us to get at what it is you've given to us, to filter away all the things that might get in our way, our own biases, our prejudices. But God, we want to know you through your word. We thank you that you've made that possible. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, good night. We'll see you next week, unless you stay.